you, Deacon Witherspoon, for bringing forth the scripture this morning. I just want us, if we know God has been good to us today,
amen.
Let's give him a hand clap of praise. Amen. He's amazing. He serves the amazing God.
Amen.
He sits high, but he looks down low.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
He's full of compassion. Amen.
Amen.
Slow of anger, full of compassion. Praise God. He is such a wonder. He's been so good to each and every one of us.
Amen. He has. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. I can only speak for myself and my only personal testimony, but I know that he is good.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I am fully persuaded of his goodness.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And I thank him. I thank you, Lord, for being amazing, for allowing your glory to be present in me. I'm glad to be in a relationship with my Father. Amen.
Yes, God. Thank you.
And I know you are as well. How many of you ready to receive the word of God this morning?
Amen.
Yes. It's amazing word of God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
The only solution.
Amen.
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 Amen. You don't have to look any further. As the song says, somebody y'all may get that one.
Yeah.
Y'all know what I'm talking about. Praise God. This morning we're going to continue on with our series around spiritual transformation. Today our focus is on leading our emotions. Leading our emotions. So last week, we talked about how spiritual transformation is an inside-out process. So I'm just going to give a few bullets of an overview on this lesson from last week. Last week, we talked about sanctification. And we looked at James 1 and 21, and we used James 1 and 21 to help us define what sanctification is. Sanctification is the process of receiving with meekness the entire gospel of Jesus Christ so that we can become the people of God, revealing his nature to our world. The process, sanctification is the process of receiving with meekness the entire gospel of Jesus Christ so that we can become the people of God, revealing his nature to our world. Sanctification is unpacking the free gift of salvation in order for us to experience its wholeness. It takes sanctifying grace, and it takes a faith of sanctification in order for us to have this spiritual transformation to take place in our lives. We talked about us as spiritual beings, and when we become born again, our spirit, we have a new spirit. And we said that as a result of us being born again, there's nothing that we can do to make ourselves more saved. And we talked about how our spirits have been addressed when we're born again. We said our bodies, our corruptible earthly bodies, are addressed when Jesus comes for us and he receives, and we receive our new bodies. We're going to receive new bodies when Jesus comes. And we said, but it's different with our souls. Our souls is a renewal process that takes place at the time that we become born again. And it continues into the time that we transition. And in order for us to be transformed, it has to begin on the inside, and it manifests on the outside. This process can only work when we allow Jesus Christ. We will allow his entire gospel to be placed inside of us through his spirit, and allow his entire word, his instrument, to reveal heaven's glory, heaven's reality to our world. So today we're going to speak on a topic that I believe we can all relate to, okay? We're going to talk about the importance of leading our emotions. Honey, can you turn down the mic, my mic's on a little bit? That may be it, Ms. Brett. Thank you. All right. So, in order for us to be effective in our spiritual transformation, in order for us to be able to renew our minds, as the scripture tells us we should be doing, we must be willing to lead our emotions versus allowing our emotions to lead us. So today, in today's message, we're going to address these bullets. We're going to talk about the value of leading our emotions. We also want to talk about emotions being a part of our being, but the problem is we're misusing them. We're misusing how we take our emotions. And then we're going to look at an illustration of what influences our emotions, and we're going to apply some real life examples, and then we're going to look at some biblical examples of people who are both, where we see people are both leading their emotions, and we'll see another example where people are allowing their emotions to lead them, okay? So we're going to first start off with our title scripture, and we're going to go to Proverbs chapter 16. We're going to look at verse 32. Proverbs chapter 16, we're going to look at verse 32. When you get there, say, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
Before I start, thank you, praise team, getting us going this morning, warming us up. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for your diligence. All right. Proverbs 16:32. Scripture says, he that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his spirit than he that taketh a city. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his spirit than he that taketh the city. First part of this verse is talking about a person who's slow to anger. We know anger is a damaging emotion, right? And that damaging emotion can be influenced by actions, right? Scripture saying a person who's slow to anger is better than a mighty warrior, a mighty soldier. And then the second part of the verse, they double up on it. And it's, the scripture says, and the person who possessed the ability to control his or her spirit, that, and we talk our flesh, because we know that flesh is at war with our spirit, our new spirit. The person who possesses the ability to control his or her flesh is greater than the one who captures an entire city. Victory in the area of leading our emotions is more challenging than capturing an entire city. And as I was studying this verse, I came upon somebody had written something about a famous Russian czar. And this Russian czar, this ruler, had conquered all of these countries, this territory, right? And they talked about a specific situation where this czar had, in a fit of rage, he accidentally threw something and he hit his gardener, and he killed the gardener as a result of his fit of rage. And you know, when the gardener passed away, he said, I've conquered many things in my life, many territories. He said, but there's one thing I haven't conquered, and that's myself. And you think about that. And church, how many times have we seen people in a fit of rage, destroy the innocent lives of people that weren't even involved, or just people in general. And how many lives have been, families have been impacted because of a fit of rage? We saw something this week. Young man was laying in bed, resting. He dies in his bed. We seen young lady washing dishes. Rage, these emotions. We see our leadership in our communities. They're running, their actions are based on emotions. That's not how God intended for us to operate, church. You know, when we examine these damaging emotions like anger, like sadness, fear, rejection, jealousy, what we need to do is we need to link them to our carnal mind. That's what I call the mind of the flesh. And these emotions, and I know Pastor Spradley has talked about this before, but it's linked to our lower mind. That's that mind that's linked to our bodies. And when we talked about in part one of our series of spiritual transformation, we talked about the spiritual warfare that is taking place in our mind between the mind of the spirit and our carnal mind, the mind of the flesh. And our emotions can help us gauge where are we? What are we functioning in? Are we functioning in the spirit, or are we functioning in the flesh? So let's go to a scripture that complements what we're talking about. Let's go to Galatians chapter 5. I'm gonna take us someplace. Galatians chapter 5. I know y'all are familiar with this verse. We're gonna look at verse 16. It's telling us how we should operate, how we should lead our emotions. And get there, say, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
All right. Scripture says, this I say then, walk in the Spirit. Didn't say walk in our emotions. It said walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary, polar opposites to one another, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led in the Spirit, you're not under the law. And then it goes through in verse 19, talks about the works of the flesh and those things that come about. These are actions that can occur as a result of emotions, that damaging emotions that are tied to our flesh. Y'all see it. Idolatry, adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, all of those. I'm not going to go into every one of them. Y'all familiar with it. But the important thing I want us to see here is that the lust of the flesh is a self-centeredness type of mindset. It's a pride mindset. It's an independent mindset. And you're not able to receive from God with that type of mindset. And transformation can't take place. When we're walking in the flesh, emotions are driving us to think, I got this. Lord, you can sit down right now. I got this. And we gotta be very, very mindful of how our decisions, our actions as believers, we're supposed to be representing Jesus Christ. So we gotta be mindful, and those emotions should help us determine where are we. Are we lined up with God? Or are we lined up with his word? Or are we wanna do what we wanna do? Amen? We have to be mindful. God created emotions as part of our being, but he never intended for his people to use them as many are doing today. And we're walking in the flesh instead of the spirit. The reason why we're doing it is because we're allowing our emotions to be our guide and not our gauge. Mm-hmm. We're allowing our emotions to be our guide and not our gauge. Our emotions are supposed to be reporting to us, but we're allowing our emotions to dictate us. There's a difference. You know, emotions can be used to diagnose where our hope is. Are we putting our trust in the Lord? Are we putting our trust in His Word? Are we tying it to the world or to our own abilities? Are the abilities of our world systems. So emotions can be used to diagnose where our hope is because they're tied to what we believe and what we value. But you see, emotions are not only tied to our fallen nature, but they're also tied to our new nature. Because they're tied to our fallen nature, that's how sin and Satan has the ability to manipulate and deceive us into acting in a manner outside the Word of God. So that's why God, fear is an example of something that the enemy places in us, right? But we know that the scripture says God did not give us a spirit of fear, but He did give us a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. One of the things that we need to understand as believers, we incorrectly apply how we use our emotions in our daily lives. And because of this incorrect application, either because we haven't been taught or we choose not to follow God's will and submit to His will, is that we're unable to grow. It's a growth stunner. When we allow our emotions to lead us, it stunts our growth. It stunts our renewing of our minds. And what we end up being is we end up being spiritual babes. We're still on the milk. And that's not what God intended for us. He didn't give us these eternal promises and these blessings and these treasures that are stored up inside of us just for it to go to waste. He wants us to use every bit of ability that He's given us through His manifold of grace system. And when we allow our emotions to direct and control us by how we feel, what happens is we're setting ourselves up for so much less than what God has planned for us. So what we're going to do now is we're going to show some scriptures showing that God the Father and Jesus the Son being spirit-led. Now, God, we were created in the image of God, right? So God, part of our nature is having emotions. So God, the Father, Jesus, the Son had emotions. The difference is how they apply emotions. And so we're going to talk about this. We're going to see how our Father, how He operates. Let's go to Psalms 145. Psalms 145, verse 8. You all there?
Jesus.
All right. Scripture says, "The Lord is gracious and full of compassion." Look at the second part. Slow to anger and of great mercy. Didn't say the Lord didn't get angry, but He was slow to it. So many people have a false representation of God and say God is just angry. He's ready to pounce on us every time we get out of line. You see, his discipline is progressive. It happens over a course of time. It's slow to anger. But sometimes we focus on the anger part, but we miss the first part when He said, full of compassion. great mercy. That's what the Lord is all about. He's leading his emotions. Jesus Christ, let's look at the Son, Jesus Christ. And we don't have to go to this scripture. But you remember in Matthew 4 when Jesus was led in the wilderness, right? He was led to the wilderness. He was there for what, 40 days, 40 nights, right? Well, can you imagine what emotions would have been present? You ain't ate nothing, ain't drank nothing in 40 days. And what happens after that 40th day? Who comes to Jesus? Satan does. His emotions were present. He was hungry. Some of us when we're hungry, we've been hungry, so we get a little angry. We got a little anger. Not only, I'm gonna pull the heart on the pastor. He was by himself. He was lonely. And I bet he was tired too. Mm-hmm. That stirs up a lot of emotions. So Satan offers Jesus was some bread, right? Mm-hmm. We know he was hungry. But did he let his emotions lead him? No, he did not. He responded to Satan. I said, man does not live by bread alone. Why every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Part of transformation is feeling and responding the way God does. That's how he wants us to operate as well, church. When our emotions, when they lead us, when they dictate us, I'm going to tell you something. People that operate on emotions, it drains them physically. You physically drained. And you can wake up and you're like, man, wow, I'm so famished. Yeah. You know? And you wake up and you're not sure how you're gonna feel each day when you're operating on emotions. Your day is gonna function based on how you feel when you wake up. And I'm gonna tell you, there's a lot of people that live like this today. That operate in this manner. They base how their day is gonna go by based on what their football team won tonight. am I telling the truth? Yeah. We got people that they'll if something don't go right or if that you know if something happens something and I know we're supposed to have compassion with our spouse or with our children, but if they're not having a good day. It could be something regular, something small. Our day is shot. Our emotional stability is based on somebody else's. That's not how God intended for us to operate, church. That wasn't his will. That's not his will for us. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to share something with you. There was a season in my life where I felt my emotions were in control of me. I don't feel like I'm a super emotional person. I do get emotional, but I'm not a super emotional. But I just felt like my emotions were in control. They were dictating how I was gonna live. Mm-hmm. And I heard a spiritual truth that really changed me. When I heard it, I confirmed it with the word, and I said, okay. I need this to be written on my heart. And that truth was this. Emotions do not represent the truth. Emotions do not represent the truth. The Word of God, the entire gospel of Jesus Christ is the only truth that we have. And I said, Father, show me where this is. He said, go to John 17:17. Y'all go there. Go ahead. Go to John 17:17. This is how I confirmed it when I heard the message. Because it spoke to me that I read it. When I read it in a book, and it spoke to me. And he had me go to John 17:17. Y'all familiar with this verse? Scripture says, John 17:17, Jesus is saying this, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. I thought about that. And then it also makes me think of John 14:6, when Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth and the life. No one can come to the Father unless they come through me. Church, when you receive this truth with meekness in your heart, it'll change you. It'll sanctify, it'll set you apart from those that are operating by letting their emotions lead them. And that's when that light bulb, when I received that message, that light bulb came on. And I came to understand at that point, at that moment, that the way I feel has nothing to do with who I am in Christ. The way I feel has nothing to do with who I am in Jesus Christ. How I feel is something that I created. So if I create it, I can choose to either walk in it, or I can choose to step out of it and walk in who I am in Jesus Christ. It's my choice. I have the power to do that. I have to be willing to say, Lord, your will is my will. And I believe if I place my will and align my will with your will, then my emotions will change. I don't have to continue to be depressed. I don't have to continue to feel condemned. I don't continue to have to be angry. I don't have to continue to be jealous or be bitter. Amen?
Amen. That's right.
So what we're going to do now is I'm going to show you an illustration. Hunter, I appreciate you helping me out here. We're going to look at can you blow it up for me? There you go. And this is just an illustration to show some of the things that can influence us and cause, you know, when dealing with our emotions. And the first thing that we want to talk about here is our circumstances. Our circumstances and our beliefs have an impact on what we think, right? And how we think can impact our emotions. And our emotions can trigger actions as a result of that. Our circumstances, if we begin with our circumstances can be uncontrollable. That can be stuff that just life. Life just happens, right? Things that's out of our control. They can be personal, they can be relational, or any other thing. Or they can be controllable things, things that we put on ourselves. There are sometimes circumstances that we place on ourselves, right? So those are our circumstances. We also, our circumstances, when circumstances come, we gotta look at our beliefs too, because our beliefs have an impact as well. Our beliefs are driven by our will to either believe in truth, which is the word of God, or error, which is false doctrine. And when we're believing in stuff that's outside the word of God, we're operating in our flesh, the old man, the carnal mind. Now, our circumstances and how we believe can lead to what we think about. They drive what we think about during the day. Our thoughts are how we frame our circumstances. Are we framing them by the word of God? Are we puffing up our circumstances? And then we talk about our emotions. Our emotions can be triggered in a couple of ways. Sometimes our circumstances can trigger an instant reaction, right? I stomp my toe, I smash my finger in the door. There's a reaction there, right? Sometimes we're gonna say some non-Sunday school words, perhaps. Amen? Let's keep it real. Sometimes somebody just strikes a nerve. You already got something in you, and a circumstance can come up, somebody can tell you something, and you don't like how they say it. What happens? There's an emotion that comes, and that emotion comes, and it immediately a reaction comes, and action takes place as a result of that emotion. Sometimes emotions can be driven by how we're thinking, how we're framing a situation. We can be, you know, something can happen. We can either be sick, and we may be sick for a little while. And we start thinking about it and pondering and not thinking about the word. We've been focusing on that circumstance. If our beliefs are not grounded, it can lead to us having some emotions that's a result of that. You know? And what's important for us to understand is our actions, our behaviors are influenced by our emotions. If we're led by the flesh, it can lead to one action. If we're led by the Spirit, it can lead to a different action. And that's why that arrow is pointing from actions to circumstances, because our actions can either better or it can worsen our circumstances based on how we're operating, whether we're operating in the flesh or whether we're operating in the Spirit. And people who are led by emotions, they make important decisions. They end up making important decisions about their life, like finding a spouse or a job or spending money. And they base all of this on a feeling. And because of this, bad choices are being made every day. And one of the pitfalls, I want us to understand this, one of the pitfalls that many people fall trap to is this: they try to change their emotions. Mm-hmm. You can't do that. Mm-hmm. It's a temporary fix. Mm-hmm. It can't be sustained, church. Mm-hmm. Another thing that we try to do with our emotions is this: we try to control our emotions, we try to subdue them and put them away. And what happens is we never end up addressing the issue at hand. What our emotions are supposed to be a gauge. When we feel, we have fear, it should bring us back to start thinking, well, what am I thinking about to cause this fear? What am I believing in that's causing this fear to happen? The key to addressing our emotions is around our beliefs and what we believe in. If what we believe in is the Word of God, then eventually, whatever emotions that we have, we have the power to lead those emotions to leave us. Amen? That's why it's so important. We have to continually set our minds on truth for our old emotions and behaviors to change. We saw this in Philippians 4, 8 through 9. Set your mind on things that are true, that are just, that are good. We gotta set, that's the key. Our emotions should be the gauge to assist us in letting us know what we are thinking, church. So let's look at some real life examples. I want to talk about some real life examples that we face, you know, that have an impact on our emotions. The first example is something we all are familiar with. It's probably the greatest spiritual battle on Sunday morning for folks going to church. It's getting here. That's a spiritual fight. that goes on, warfare that goes on every morning. And sometimes your circumstance, sometimes it can be, you know, weather, it can be cold outside, it could be raining, or you just could have had, it could have been controlled. You just had a good time Saturday night. You just enjoyed yourself a little bit too much, stayed up a little bit too late. And you triggered. And then them emotions, what emotions trigger from that? Ooh, you wake up, you're tired. Ooh, I'm so tired. Ooh, I can just get about 10, 15 more minutes of sleep. You know? Man, maybe I can. I remember back in the day, I was like, boy, when I was in college, you know, mom and them, I didn't have mom and them. You know, mom and them didn't say you got to go to church. I was in college, I was like, oh yeah, let me get about, I get about 30 more minutes. I walk in, I show my face about, you know, when the pastor started preaching. Man, I didn't even show up. Next thing I know, it's 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Amen.
Amen. And it happens, it's a spiritual battle. You know, you wake up in the morning, you know you're tired. You get this tired emotion, but one of the things that the Lord always plants into me in the morning when I think about wanting to stay in the bed a little longer, he said, man doesn't live by bread alone, son. Man doesn't live by bread alone. And I start, and then that belief starts to take place. That my beliefs start to build up and say, time to get up, Steve. Man don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. He don't live by bread alone. And so my belief says, okay, flesh, sit down, go some. I'm getting rid of you. It's time to get up. It's time to go to church. Time to get ready. I'm about to be fed spiritually. If I lay in this bed, I'm going to miss this spiritual nourishment that God has for me.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Amen? It provides vitality, growth, development. I value that. I figured everybody can relate to that. I'm gonna give you another one. And this second example is something that we all is prevalent amongst our generation today. Social media.
Mm-hmm.
This is a trap here. Okay, we put something on Facebook, we put something on Instagram or Snapchat or whatever. Put the first thing out, everybody liking it. They liking it all over the place. Oh, you get some friend requests, they share your post to some other people. Oh, it makes you feel real good, don't you? Make you feel real good. You get all puffed up and feeling good about stuff. Then you post something about an hour later. Nobody hits you. You get no response back. Right? And you wonder, why nobody didn't respond to my pic? You know, why didn't they respond to what I had said? And then you start thinking about, well, maybe they don't value me like I should. And then all of a sudden you start some hate and some anger start rising up in you. I said earlier, we have people that operate based on their emotions, based on what they see on Facebook, based on what they put in Facebook. It's an emotional roller coaster. Emotions are all over the place. Our leaders are being driven, being led by their emotions and by the stuff that's being posted on social media. We have to be grounded and knowing that other people's opinions or responses don't determine our value, church. God determines our value. God determines our value. It's a big problem. We gotta be mindful as believers. We gotta use the, that's how a tool can be used by the enemy to have us operating outside of God's will. That's just one example. There's some good in it, but we have, as believers, got to understand how we function, how we should be functioning. Amen?
Amen.
Third example. This happens to folks that go to work. You wake up in the morning, you get ready to go to work, and you're already stressed. You're already tense. You can't even, some of it affected, you can't even go to sleep that night. And it's got to be, you know, something's going on as a circumstance that's been going on at work. Somebody you know, you've been catching some flack from somebody, and it's bothering you. You got a tough meeting, you know, you're getting ready, you've been preparing for, and you know they're trying to railroad you in the meeting, and you're worried about it, and it just all, you get up depressed. You got a deadline you're trying to meet. They're giving you unrealistic expectations on it. And what happens? That's that circumstance. Our beliefs are not balancing with our circumstances. When our beliefs are not at that right level to balance off our circumstances, what happens is it's impacting our thoughts. It impacts our emotions. What we got to do, church, we got to go back. When we start feeling like that, we got to go back. What am I thinking about? Didn't God say, what did God's word say about things? He said that weapons may form against me, but they shall not prosper. Didn't God's word say all things work together for good that are calling them that love the Lord and call according to his purpose? We got to start going back to our beliefs. When we see our emotions going, that should be an alarm for us to say, okay, let's step back. Let's reassess this thing, because I'm outside of God's will. I'm operating outside of his will. I want to make sure I get myself back in alignment. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Understand when you're in those situations, understand whose mind you have. The scripture says that we have the mind of Christ in us. Amen. And I trust and believe that his manifold of grace will supply me with whatever I need in my situation. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Y'all want to look at some biblical examples? Let's look at some biblical examples. We're going to look at somebody who actually, in this particular case, they let their emotions lead them. And we're going to talk about Peter. We're going to look at John chapter 18. Y'all familiar with this particular passage, John 18. We're going to look at verse 4. This is where Peter, when they come to the Pharisees and the chief priests come to take Jesus, to arrest Jesus, and before he is crucified. And we see the circumstance in this particular case is Jesus being arrested. So if we go to John 18:4, we'll start reading in verse 4. So the chief priests and Pharisees show up, and the scripture says, Jesus therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, he's already, and we know Jesus knows this is going to happen. In fact, he shared it with the disciples on multiple times that this was going to happen. All right? So knowing all these things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? And then the chief priests and the Pharisees said, they answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said unto him, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. And as soon as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. Then asked he them again, whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus answered in verse 8, said, I have told you that I am he. If therefore ye seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled which he spake, of them which thou gavest me have I lost none. Let's see what Peter does. This is the scenario. He's getting ready to be arrested. So we know there's some circumstances. Let's see how Peter responds. Of course, there's a lot of emotions that's involved in this, right? Jesus is getting ready. His father is getting ready to be arrested. It says in verse 10, then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and smote the high priest's servants and cut off his right ear. And the servant's name was Malchus. Then said Jesus, Jesus responded to Peter and said, put up thy sword into the sheath. The cup which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? Jesus told his disciples on multiple occasions that this was happening. But Peter was emotionally led. His actions weren't based on the truth that was spoken to him by Jesus. And instead of allowing God's will to take place as Jesus had forewarned him, what he did was he took the circumstances into his own hands. And he pulled his sword out and he cut off the ear of one of the high priest's servants. The key I want us to understand is this. We must not allow our emotions to pull us out of God's will for our lives. Church, sometimes we gotta endure some things. We gotta endure some things in our lives. We can't just always escape from it, church. And although his response to some may have seemed good, it may have looked good, it may have felt good, but it wasn't God's will. It wasn't God's will. And it wasn't for his good. That's why we have to be sure to always align ourselves with God before we act on anything and not let our emotions lead our actions. So in Bible study Wednesday, we're going to show the opposite side of Peter when he responds the right way, because he did change. And we'll see it. We'll see an example in Sunday school. Let's look at another example. I want to show you an example where emotions were not being this particular woman was leading her emotions first and allowing her emotions to lead her. We're going to go to Matthew. We're going to look at the story of the Canaanite woman. Matthew 15. And we're going to start at verse 21. Matthew 15. We're going to start at verse 21. Everybody there?
Jesus, Lord.
It says, verse 21, it says, then Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. That's the circumstance, isn't it? Mm-hmm. That's the circumstance. Out of her control. Stuff is, yeah. But he answered not a word. That was Jesus' response. He answered not a word to her. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she cried after us. He said, but he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That didn't stop her. Then she came and worshiped him and saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to the dogs. Ooh, sometimes. This is another circumstance that just comes upon. Jesus just responds to her in a way that many of us, if that was somebody, you wouldn't, emotions would be erupting in this particular case. Sometimes circumstances will come to test what we really believe. This was her test. Do you really believe that I had the power to heal your daughter? Are you gonna allow what I say to you to influence how you gonna believe? Let's look at how she responds. And she says, true, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. From that very hour. Jesus made a remark just to see how she would respond. Would she respond emotionally? Or would she respond by faith? She may have felt disrespected. She may have felt hurt, but her feelings didn't influence her response to Jesus Christ because she led her emotions by what she believed. And as a result of that, Jesus responded to her by healing her daughter. Amen.
Amen.
Three key takeaways. Emotions should be used as our gauge and not our guide. Emotions should be used as our gauge in how we're thinking and believing and not our guide to influence our actions. Second point we need to understand is this. Emotions don't represent the truth. God's word is true. His word is our anchor that we stand on. His word is our standard for living. Emotions don't represent the truth. God's word is true. Third point we need to understand is this. We must choose with our own free will that he's given us. We have to choose to continually set our minds on the truth, the entire gospel of Jesus Christ, for our old emotions and behaviors to change. We must choose to continually set our minds on the truth for our old emotions and behaviors to change. One of the things I want you to understand is this. Emotions are probably the hardest thing for us to change. It's the slowest to change. Typically the slowest to change. But I want you to understand, don't give up. You got to continue to press forward. That's why we got to focus on building our belief systems up. Building up what we believe. Building up who we are in Christ. Understanding who we are in Christ. And basing our actions on who we are in Christ and not our feelings. One of the things that I want to share with you before I close is this. And this is something personal that I if my emotions get real low and I'm depressed, if my emotions are really are influencing me and I'm struggling, one of the things I do, I put on some praise. I start praising God. Either I speak praises or I listen to some music that inspire me to praise him. Because when I praise him, my mind is off my circumstances and off this moment, and I put my focus on him. The scripture says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. And when we get in those moments where we're low, give him some praise. That's your time. Find you a place and start lifting up his name, talking about the promises that he's given to. I'm more than a conqueror. You're so amazing. Amen. Lord, you're good and your mercy endure forever. God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom. That cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, the enemy is defeated, and I will shout it out. I will shout it out. Amen? That's what we got to do. Church, I hope the message has blessed you. And we're going to give some more examples on Sunday about some other people, biblical examples. But just be mindful. Our emotions are the gauge, not to guide. We are people of faith, and we walk in the Spirit. Amen? God bless you. The door of the church is open.